we're at the site here. This is Jabal Rahmah, and this is Arafah. So what I wanted to kind of maybe put a reminder forward about is the Hajjatul Wada', which is the last speech of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in many ways one of the most important speeches he's ever done. Okay, and it was done on the day of Arafah, in fact. And in that speech, subhanAllah, you'll find that he covers there's so much coverage of different subjects in that particular speech, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made his kind of final grand speech. And he made that speech in front of 124,000 people. Now you remember, we talked about how the Prophet and the companions were being tortured in Mecca, and how they were forced into secrecy in terms of like professing their faith and so on and so forth. So from those humble beginnings, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went all the way to being able to preach Islam to 124,000 people, which, if you think about the population of the world at the time, was a massive crowd. 124,000 people in this site where the Prophet was talking about things. And what did he mention? What did he want us to know? What are the things, what are the themes that he wanted us to kind of ponder on in his speech? Where the Sahaba themselves, they realized that this might be the very last speech of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he talked about things which are very pertinent to both, on both a macro level and a micro level. He talked about riba. He talked about interest. He talked about tawheed, monotheism. He talked about family rights and women's rights. He talked about racism. He talked about all the things that the West took, you know, 1,400 years to kind of catch up on. Let's be honest about it.
SubhanAllah.
Yeah, SubhanAllah. So the Prophet Muhammad, for example, he focused on tawheed and the prayers and so on and so forth. But he also talked about the umur of jahiliyyah, the ways in which the people of the pre-Islamic age used to operate. And in particular, he talked about riba, which is interest-based systems. And he says that all of the riba is mawdu'ah. All of the riba, all of the interest is to be kind of stricken off now. We don't deal in those ways. And this strikes at the heart of the capitalistic system. As Muslims, we're not capitalists. We're not profit maximizers. We don't believe in redistribution. You know, the Prophet told us there are ways in which you can make a halal earning. There are ways in which you can deal with people and benefit them and be benefited by them. Well, the Quran even says, وَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الْرِبَى, that Allah has allowed trade, but He has not allowed riba, He has not allowed interest. And why did the Prophet mention and emphasize this? Because he knew, as he mentioned in other hadiths, that there will come a time where riba will cover everything. And he actually mentioned this in a hadith, and he said that there will come a time where riba or interest will cover absolutely everything, to the extent whereby you won't be able to shake yourself from the dust of it. And you have to try your best to keep away from it as much as possible. And which is a lesson to us in the West as Muslims, because that's one of the fitan for us. We think about mortgages, we think about loans with interest and so on and so forth. The Prophet, in his very final sermon in front of 124,000 people, made it a point of concentration, of emphasis. But he also talked about what? Women's rights. وَاسْتَوْسُ بِالنِّسَاءِ خَيْرًا. He said, be good to your wives. He said, be good to your wives. Why? Because he said...
Now why are you smiling, brother? What's going on?
Yes. Because he said that you have taken them with a covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you imagine this, where the Prophet has limited time and he has limited subject matters to talk about. What is he choosing? He's choosing the things which, if they go wrong, society will crumble. For example, if society chooses as the West, then you're going to have incredible boom and incredible bust, as you do have in the Western economic system. If a society chooses to have domestic problems, especially where women are mistreated, then you're going to have problems in that society. And it took the West so much time to come to a conclusion that some kind of women's rights were required. But the Prophet talked about that very long time ago. You know, he talked, what else? He talked about, as we said, tawheed.
Racism.
Racism, right? We said that there's no difference between a white man and a black man and a black man. And he said this also when he done Fatih Mecca. When he opened up Mecca and he stood in front of the Kaaba, and Bilal done the adhan in front of the Kaaba. He was a black man who in fact was being whipped and hurt by those individuals, and he was screaming and shouting Ahadul Ahad. But then he came to the time, he came where he was doing the adhan. SubhanAllah, the same voice which was in humiliation became the voice of enfranchisement with the voice of authority. Yes, he did the adhan, proclaiming the tawheed that he was proclaiming in a situation of desperation, both in Arafah and Fatah Makkah, as a black man in front of all of those tribal individuals. And in fact, some Arabs of the non-Muslims were saying, why is this black man, subhanAllah, how could he be the one over us like this? And this shows you the extent to which Islam came to abolish slavery and abolish racism and those things. Yes, so you have to understand something of Islam. In that last speech, he gave us so much hope. He gave us so much points of concentration. And as a homework, what we should do is go back to that speech, what he did in Arafah, where he spoke in front of 124,000 people, and revise those points of consideration.